Hey everyone, Andrew here from the Tale of Two Hygienists podcast. Yes, you are on the right feed, but no, this is not a normal show. I wanted to let you know right now that what you are about to hear is not suitable for work. It is likely also not appropriate for children. If you are sensitive to racy topics, go ahead and hit that delete button right now. You might not like this episode. But now that you've been warned, please welcome to a special RDH Rant Takeover episode with Heather, Anna, and Lizz.
Hey, welcome back to another RDH Rant Takeover episode. I am Heather, and joining me, like always, are Lizz and Anna. Say hi.
Hello.
Hi.
As we talked about in the past, Guygienists, how there's a lack of them. Where are you? Out there, because I know that there are, because we get more and more requests from guys, and we're always kind of like, is this really a guy, you know, a Guygienist? Because we also feel like a lot of people are trying to get into our group.
Yeah, I always automatically assume whenever we get a request for with a guy, I'm always like, it's a dentist.
Yes. Yeah. Our group. But it shouldn't be like that. Yes, it shouldn't be like that.
Exactly.
Yeah. So that's what today's episode is about. So we have an extra special guest with us, Mr. Chris Williams. He is a Guygienist, founder of the Prophy Kings, co-founder of the Dental Culture Con. He is a speaker and, as he likes to put it, a serial entrepreneur. Welcome.
Hi, Chris.
Hey, Rant Ladies. Hey.
Hey, welcome. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. I know you have a busy schedule, so we appreciate your time. But I just want to ask, because, you know, I've known you as Chris Williams. Who is Chris Love?
Okay. Well, Chris Love is... Are you asking about that name specifically? Like, where does Chris Love come
from?
Yeah.
When I look you up, because I do my research...
Mm-hmm. Stalker.
I'm a creeper. Sorry. No, I just like to know. But Chris Love keeps popping up.
Yeah. So Chris Love is Chris Williams. That is who I am. I am a United States Air Force veteran that has gone dental hygienist. So my career life started in the military when I was 19. I served 4 years in the Air Force, one tour to Afghanistan, and I am now a registered dental hygienist, entrepreneur, and all those other small accolades that you...
No, they're not small.
No, not at all.
Yeah. I personally thank you for your service.
My pleasure.
Absolutely.
Yeah. How do you go from that, though, to a dental hygienist? Did you do dental work in the service?
No. In the Air Force, I was actually a cop. So I was a military police officer. But yeah, my journey into dentistry really just came from me in that transitional period when I got out in 2012. At the time, I was about maybe 23, 24 years old. And I had two kids and I was married. And
damn, that's young.
Yeah. And I had to make a decision on the track for my life, right? And I was taking that time very seriously. I was like, okay, now I'm out of the military. It was very scary for me because I didn't know what it was like in the civilian world as an adult.
Yeah.
That
makes sense. I guess I wouldn't have thought about that.
Yeah. When I was in 2009, when I was still, you know, well into being in the service, I heard about the economy, like the economy's crashing and things like that. And I didn't even know what that meant, what that felt like. Because I was, one, young and hadn't really experienced life outside of the military. And, you know, you're a federal employee, essentially, you're taken care of, right? Like, our healthcare benefits were the best that I think you could probably get. A paycheck first and the 15th, guaranteed, no matter how many days I worked or, you know what I'm saying? Like, so I really had no real experience with what it was like in the civilian world. And so when I got out, I knew that I had to figure it out. I had to make a decision on what I was going to do with my life now. And I knew I wanted to go to college. That was one of the drawing factors for me even going into the service, was the fact that they would pay for college 100%.
Yeah,
yeah, absolutely. And,
but I just couldn't focus on that while I was in. I think being a police officer and security, base security, right, and all of what that entailed really just made me feel like I didn't have the bandwidth to go to school. So I saved it for when I got out.
Good.
Yeah, and I basically sat down with a pencil and paper and wrote down the different careers that I was interested in. I literally planned this out, guys. Like I wrote those out. I wrote out the steps that it would take to actually become each one.
Yeah.
And how long it would take.
You decided that being in law enforcement was not for you.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I really learned that.
Real quick, I think you should share a picture of yourself in uniform in Rant. Just saying. But go ahead. Keep going.
You're going to see a baby-faced Chris, like,
way different. I would love to see it. I would love to see baby-faced Chris. 19-year-old Chris. Aw. I bet you would. So cute.
Just like a man in uniform.
Law enforcement, yeah. Law enforcement, not for you. So you decided, like, the careers that you were thinking about, were they more like, you know, helping people, more, I guess, caring, not as hard-edged?
Yeah, so 100%. So I wanted to do something, one, that brought me real fulfillment in my job. Being a cop, there was a tug of war there, because it was like, it felt good to be needed, but then it also didn't feel good because we were also just, like, not everyone's favorite people. Right.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. Absolutely.
Like, we're the people who pull you over. We're the people who hassle you at the gate if you don't have your right credentials. Right. And you just want to get into work or whatever. Right. But you got us, like, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Writing tickets. Yeah. And,
well, I think we can kind of relate. Like, nobody likes to come to the dentist. Nobody likes us.
Right, exactly.
It's the first thing they say when they come in our office. Yeah.
Nobody don't still like likes us, Chris. Like, nothing's changed.
So I really made a bad decision to jump to another career field that has that. But I think it's that service to people was a big thing for me. But you asking about the specific jobs that were on my list, let me tell you what was on there. So I had dentist as number one. Mm-hmm. That's because I always had an affection towards smiles. And I always felt like I would love to have a really nice smile myself, because I grew up with a diastema. And so I didn't really particularly like my teeth. And so that became something I was like, I could be a dentist. I would love to help people be more confident in their smiles. And I want to be more confident in mine. So I was interested in that. Then I had actor, because I was growing up, I was in acting. I had animator, because I'd always been an artist, and I've been drawing since I was a little kid. And
oh, that's cool. I didn't know that. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so I really, when I looked at these things, though, I had, like, tough conversations with myself, because I was thinking to myself, right, I want to be an animator, but my goal is to not just be, like, an average animal. Like, I want to work for Pixar.
You want to be like, you know, Walt Disney.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't know how realistic that will be for me right now as a father and a husband. And I want to do something that's going to make where I'm not chasing something that is, I don't want to say unattainable, but something that would just take a long time potentially.
Yeah.
Yes.
So
time wasn't of essence at that moment in your life.
Yeah, I was like, I have a solid 5-year plan that I want to drastically change things. I just got out of the military, which was already a really drastic move. And now I'm going to be going to college. And then what is this going to? And listen, so I was super methodical about this, because even in my mindset, I was thinking about all the people that are in my life, like family members, any adults that are in their 30s or 40s. That are not doing what they love and are still trying to figure it out and trying to chase something.
Right.
And I just really wanted to make a decision that was going to put me within the next 5 years in a place where I had autonomy in my life and financial stability, so that I could pour into any passions that I have.
Good.
So what was college like for you then going into, well, you said that you know, your end goal was to be a dentist, but starting off going to hygiene school, obviously you were in the minority, number one, because you are male, and number two, because you are Black. So what was that like for you? Did you have male classmates that you could kind of commiserate with, or how was that experience?
Yeah. So interestingly, I did. I had two other male hygienists that were in school, or prospective hygienists at that time. And guess what? We were all three military guys too.
So that was really
super cool.
Oh, yeah. That is really cool.
Me as the Air Force guy.
Different branches.
Yep. Wow. Marines and Army were the other two.
All right.
Well, that was cool. At least you had somebody to, you know, complain about us girls about.
And somebody with the same background as you. I mean, that's, you know, at least you all kind of knew where you're coming from, even though I'm sure there was some of that, like mock animosity between the branches.
The branches.
Yeah.
For sure. But nonetheless, you know, anywhere, we do have that all the time. That's all day long. We got that kind of like, we pick on each other, like the different branches, right? But at the end of the day, we all serve the same military, you know? So it's just jokes, you know? It's just like you're picking on picking on your brother or sister, you know?
Yeah.
So when did you graduate? How long have you been a hygienist?
I graduated 2016.
In 2016. Okay. All right. And so...
So that's about 7 years now.
And so you're not a dentist, okay, right? So
No.
So tell us what's going on with that. Is that you just decided, nah... I'm happy where I am. Being a dentist is not for me. What happened to the dentist thing?
Yeah, you know, this is life, man. We have these plans, right? We set a plan further out, and then through the process, it kind of shifts and morphs. So, yeah, as I got into dentistry, learned more about this industry, I really took a deep look at what do I want this for? Like, why do I want to be a dentist? Why am I going to go to school for all these years, attain this debt? Right. Mm-hmm. And I really came to the conclusion that I would just be a dentist doing the same thing that I'm doing now. You'd just be talking to Dr. Williams instead. Right. Like I would still be a speaker. I would still be an entrepreneur. You know, I would still not want to work clinically full time.
Right.
That would just be a reality, because as a hygienist, I got to a point where I was like, I don't want to do this full time.
Right.
I don't want to just be in the clinic.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed being outside of the clinic, but I loved my journey through my clinical time, if that makes sense.
So at the top of the show, we mentioned how when we even have to check our own biases sometimes, because when we have a male who wants to join RDH Rant, we automatically think, whoa, is this a dentist? So did you feel any kind of societal pressure from patients, from family, from yourself to become a dentist?
Well, okay, that's interesting. So since I came into this originally wanting to be a dentist, I never had any societal pressures really, because it was already a choice for me to want to be a dentist. But then once I was kind of in as a hygienist and I'm just practicing as a hygienist and I would get patients who were like, I love the fact that you're a hygienist and you're a Black man and this and that, right? So when are we going back to school? When are you gonna? And I'm like, I'm not. I'm actually good, you know, like where I am.
Yeah.
I'm an entrepreneur and I'm a hygienist. I'm a proud hygienist. So sometimes there is that pressure where people just automatically assume, I think, because you're a guy and you're a hygienist, that your goal is to become the dentist.
Right.
Otherwise, why are you know, why aren't you? Almost like that, right?
Right.
But
I wonder if like male nurses probably experience something similar to that. Like,
I think so.
I bet.
Yeah.
I bet.
My brother-in-law is a male nurse and, you know, he's a MRSE. I don't know if that's considered a bad term for guy nurses or not.
Think so.
Yeah.
I've also heard that it was like men who like that have a bag, like a satchel or whatever, that they call it a MRSE instead of a purse. I had a hygienist or not a hygienist, a patient who actually said the same thing. He called it the MRSE.
Oh yeah. I didn't think of that.
It's like, is there anywhere to hang my MRSE? And I was like, you're what? My man purse. Oh, okay.
You're a what?
You're what? behind your merce.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Chris, in school, did you feel like, because you were one of the minorities being a male, did you feel that affected anything positive or negatively for you while you were in school?
I think, honestly, I've had a lot of positive experiences around things that I thought would be negative.
Mm-hmm.
I think internally, because of the way dental hygiene as a career presents itself, that it creates this uncertainty amongst us guys where we're unsure about the acceptance, right? From not only the offices, but also like the patients.
Yeah.
And, you know, maybe them being a little turned off from the idea that a guy is going to be doing their prophylaxis or their deep cleaning, right? Like they assume that this might be a bit more intense, that it's going to be, you might be a little rough with me, you know, I'm small, you know, and then you already have people in a very disadvantaged position by laying them back and they're looking at you upside down. Yeah. Right.
And so having the fear of the dentist. And now I have this guy with big hands and muscles and I already think it's going to hurt. So this is going to be the worst because he's stronger.
Right. And then if you have like a lower kind of voice also like me, but I think naturally when people actually meet me, they don't feel threatened. But I think the fear is always there, right? That if I approach and my voice is deeper, you know, they might not feel like they're going to get the white girl, blonde hair, blue eyes, real sweet, you know, girl next door.
Yeah.
Whatever they were assuming might walk out to get them. And then they get me with my beard and tattoos and, you know, stocky Bill, look like I'm about to cause some pain, maybe. You know? Who knows?
Yeah.
I know personally, I would be like, hell yes. If I was.
And that's what. And that's the thing that I think us as guys, we get, but the fear is always there. Right. But I think society, and this is, I was just talking to somebody about this recently. It's just about representation. So I was at the Hinman and another company wanted to talk about the disparity of, you know, the gender disparity here in dentistry. And it's very real. But what I think would change it is just the increasing of representation of not only men in this profession, but also this profession in general. I think that when you think about it, and you could list off, all four of us could probably list a bunch of medical shows that exist on TV.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. Grey's Anatomy, Scrubs, New
Scrubs.
Amsterdam.
Me too.
These are all like medical shows, right?
Yeah.
And you can watch, and there's even reality shows around the medical field, right? Mm-hmm. Dr. Miami and all these things, right? So dentistry has no representation out there when it comes to how we show up. Now, the only time that hygienists, I've noticed they started picking up a little bit is on like some of the commercials, they'll say dentist and hygienist approved.
Right.
Finally.
Yeah, I started to notice that they're saying hygienist more, which is really nice to hear.
Mm-hmm. Right. And we are, this industry is almost still very much predated. Like we are so behind when it comes to everything that is, you know, like where we should be as an industry comparative to the medical field.
Yeah.
We should be a lot further along. We're still fighting for things that should have been changed a long time ago.
Yeah, I agree.
Like
with
why
that.
Are certain states where hygienists can't do local anesthesia and others where they can? And so our scope of practice is just like all over the place, and to me that creates a look of messiness. Like why is it so messy in our field when in the medical field you have nurses, they have general reciprocity where their license works
any state.
Well, you know, people's mouths from state to state change, right?
Like,
state has a difference, so you have to go and relearn it all.
Exactly. Maybe in Alabama it might be
I had a nurse in my chair and we were talking about that. And I said something about the weather being awful because it's Indiana. So she said, you know, why don't you move somewhere warmer? And I said, oh, if I had to move it would be just a giant shit show. And she said, why? I was talking about professionally. And she said, why? And I said, I had to take like 5 board exams to become a dental hygienist. And she was like, what? She could not even believe it. I was like, yeah.
Yeah. They have like 1 test, right?
Yeah, I think.
On a computer. I don't know.
So she had no clue. And I said, I would have to go, depending on where I went, of course, I would have to take some of those, if not all of them, again. And she was just like absolutely blown away. So I don't think that people realize that we don't have that kind of portability.
Mm-hmm. Just crazy.
Yeah.
It's bananas. It makes no sense at all. But I think actually with the increased representation of men in the field, it'll help to also level out the employment scales where we have lost a lot of hygienists post-pandemic.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
As we start. Yeah, as we're in this transition and we start to shift and change our career field by increasing more men, working state to state to equalize our licensure, mm-hmm. I think that'll also in turn raise the value of our career field. And then we'll be looking at dental hygiene as a totally different represented career in the future.
I would say it. Like
probably within the next 5 to 10 years,
I do see some big changes. Different. Yeah, I do see some big changes mm-hmm. on the horizon, just based on what you were saying with, you know, legislation kind of being everywhere as to what we can and can't do, but also opening up new territory, like, was it Maine and Colorado and is it Minnesota or one of those other cold states where they can end up, that's how I judge things,
because
right?
They're cold.
Like, I'm not moving there. I like that they can do this, but I'm not moving there. Where they can do simple extractions and do simple fillings and the dental therapist yeah. role
mm-hmm.
expanding like that.
100%.
I like that. And then I know that we had kind of talked before recording before, and I remember that you had mentioned something very interesting about changing the name of our role.
Yeah.
Expand on that a little.
For sure. So dental hygiene, I think, is a role that we've, or a title that we've all accepted to this at this point because of, you know, it just is what it is, right? But mm-hmm. I think a lot of us would echo that being called a dental hygienist gives off the connotation that we only do cleanings.
And exactly. It devalues what we actually do.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like if we amongst each other, we can say with understanding like, hey, I do hygiene or I'm doing hygiene today. Right. But if you say that to mm-hmm. someone else, they think of hygiene as cleanliness. Right. Mm-hmm. Like cleaning something. I'm doing my personal hygiene today. Right. So to be called a dental hygienist means to say that we are teeth cleaners. Mm-hmm. But then, and this is where the confusion happens in our industry, because we say I'm a dental hygienist, but then we also have to say, but I don't just clean teeth.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah.
Why is your title a teeth cleaner then?
Yeah.
Right. So I think mm-hmm. that if we change the name of our career field.
Non-surgical periodontal therapist. That's one of the ones right. that's always popped up.
One yep. people can't say.
Even a dental therapist would
yeah, or something
along those lines that mm-hmm. let people know that we actually treat the mouth and we're capable mm-hmm. of treating the mouth and not and cleaning the mouth.
Yeah, treating the
it's
mouth.
It's funny, before I became a dental hygienist, I didn't know what a dental hygienist was. I had to actually ask someone that I knew that was a dental hygienist. I'm like, what is that? Like, I had no idea.
Mm-hmm. I was same.
Yeah. And yeah. then she was like, oh, you go to school for 2 years. You know, she didn't tell me about the prerequisites being another 2 years. But anyway, you know, and then, you know, it just was shocking to me. I'm like, I never knew that that was like a career option. And that's actually how I got into dental hygiene. But that's another whole nother story. But,
right.
but it's funny how many people don't know what a dental hygienist actually does. It really is. Yeah,
because we see things in the mouth. That, I mean, we treat, yes, the mouth, but by extension, we treat the body for yeah. a lot of our patients. Not, you know, not all of them. I guess we maintain them, but, you know, we treat the whole body for mm-hmm. people with diabetes and, you know, autoimmune and dry mouth and, you know, other systemic issues. So I agree with you, Chris, that I think that dental mm-hmm. hygienist just kind of devalues just the depth of what we do.
Yeah, for sure.
Well,
I'm on board. I'm on board with your name change. Teeth.
There's gums and bone and tissue. And
yeah, right,
they just right. think of the dentist, you know, and the white part that we scrape.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Absolutely.
And I think even in the UK, a dental hygienist is not called a dental hygienist. They're called dental nurses.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I would be okay with being called that. I don't think that would bother me. I think it would be more appropriate.
It's better than being called a cleaning lady.
Yeah.
Yeah. Tooth janitor.
Because I think a lot of people see our see our treatment as a, like, I guess, like a luxury or commodity or a service, like getting your hair done, than a medical health care procedure. So, yeah.
Do you guys ever notice? Do you ever notice the huge difference? I mean, I'm sure you do. This is almost rhetorical, but let's just chime in anyway.
Okay.
But the difference in the medical field and the way even their appointments are handled and the relationship with the patient. When our patients come to us, they have no patience when it comes to waiting.
For us
to see the patient. Many times I've gone to medical offices for an appointment. It could be a simple checkup. And I'm there. I need to make sure I'm there on time, first of all. But they don't need to make sure they're on time.
Right.
Exactly. Right?
And I'm going to wait in the lobby until they call me. And I'm going to sit in that cold room until whoever comes in and does whatever they need to do. You know what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
Yes. And I'm just going to take it. I'm not going to complain. I don't think, you know.
Well, it doesn't matter because they won't put up with it.
Exactly.
They don't. So, they're running behind and they're not on their hands and knees going out to get their patient. I'm so sorry, you know,
right.
Like, yeah,
well, you're lucky it was only this long. Let's go.
Exactly. Then that creates a difference. Then also in dentistry, we often feel like we're selling treatment.
Yes.
And the medical field just says, this is what you have and this is what you need. And they say, oh my God, okay. Well, can I get a prescription today? Or when can I be seen? Or, you know, they're ready to start. And we have all of this. I just would love to go to some CE and see if they get talked to about treatment acceptance.
Yep.
If there's like if they beat that across the head like really hard in the medical field where it's like, hey, you know, treatment acceptance is low, guys. I doubt it. I don't know, though. I'd love for somebody to know
diabetes numbers up.
You want to know something? And speaking of, you know, medical people going to CD, in the state of Indiana, nurses do not have to have any CE.
None. Really?
Zero.
Interesting.
Yep.
Wow.
I saw that online. I said, that cannot be true. That is absolutely false. And I looked it up and it is true. Well,
you found it online. It has to be true.
No, I checked and double-checked. And I was like, is this old? Like, what is it? And maybe since I checked like a year ago, it has changed. But that blew my damn mind. So anyway, I mean, not dogging on nurses. It is what is. They are what they are. I think, you know, they're heroes and they're made of something I am not. But that really blew my mind. So anyway, that was just a little tangent that it reminded me of.
So the real reason behind this podcast is to talk about like what it's like being a guygienist in a female dominated field. So I kind of want to know, Chris, you went through school, you went through all that. You didn't really have any issues in school, which is awesome. When you graduated, did you find it hard to find a job because you were a male?
Well, I wasn't entirely free of any issues being a male hygienist. Mm-hmm. So I had my first experience in school where I had someone deny being seen, or I won't say deny being seen, but they just didn't want to be seen by me because I was a guy. But at that time, that was, I think, due to religious reasons.
Okay.
I think she also had her husband with her. And I think she just wanted to be seen by a woman.
Yeah.
And I really took no offense to that at all. I think, and it depends on the context of why somebody is denying, you know, seeing you because of you being a man. So in the career, I had a woman who didn't want to see me because she said, I don't want to be seen by a guy because his hands are going to be too big. And she hadn't even seen me yet. She just said, I don't want a guy. Hands are too big. My mouth is really small. And we were in kind of a juxtaposition with that because I'm the only hygienist. The dentist was slammed. She was super busy and she needed to be seen. So I just asked if I could, if we could still seat her in the room. I was like, just still seat her in the room. So we sat her in the room. I came in just to introduce myself to her because she literally made that up before she even was brought back and seen who I was, right? Exactly. And I could have small hands. I could have had small hands.
Yeah.
But
you know what they say about small hands.
Gloves. Anna Marie, Sarah, Jessica, Parker, Sven. You stop it.
Anyway. But I knew that even with that, because I've had patients before who have small mouths, I just would say, I mean, this is what I told her. I said, well, when you go to dental hygiene school, we're trained very well with our hands. And I'm not going to stick my whole hand in your mouth. I actually use instruments as extensions of my fingers. So, So I'll be able to reach, you know, the last tooth in your mouth without even putting my whole hand in there.
I'm going to start saying that to every patient that says that to me. Like, my mouth is small. My mouth is small.
And so are my instruments. I'm like,
yeah, that's good.
Yeah. One. Yeah. So once I went in, I said, if you would just allow me the opportunity to win you. And if it's uncomfortable or anything, then we can just stop. But if you don't feel any pain or you're not in any discomfort, then maybe we could continue and we could finish your appointment. And she was like, okay. So we're just asking for her just to trust me for a second until I give her a reason not to.
And it all worked out.
And then she was like, that was a great appointment.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, that's, we kind of asked that. Well, we did, but this was just a random post from Odie. Shout out to Odie.
Shout out, Odie.
He had said shortly after we decided to do this type of podcast, it said, I just had a 23-year-old male patient on my schedule who declined to see me because I'm a male. This is pretty rare in the Dallas area. I understand religious objections because our doctors are all female. I have no problem with that. This guy just wanted to be seen by a female. The hygienist struggle is sometimes a reality. Then he adds, I guess I could get breast augmentation to make my boobs bigger, but my wife of nearly 32 years doesn't recommend that. So that kind of what just piggies back on what you said about being a male, but understanding the religious aspect of it. People still like just don't want to.
Yeah. Because shout out to Odie.
Yeah.
For sure. And that experience and you know, it's always a good thing to share our experiences in our community so that we know what we're going through on all fronts. So Odie shedding light on that is something that is a rarity, I would say, but it's very real. And so guys need to be prepared to, you know, for that. But we also have to relish in the fact that it doesn't happen as often. So that's really good. So sharing along with that, how many patients actually really love you because you're a guy. That is
exactly,
that's an experience that I hear a lot from other guys.
Yeah. When we asked these questions, another person posted that after they broke through to a patient that was nervous or leery because they were a guy, after the cleaning, they said that he was a breath of fresh air.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. And that's the message. Mm-hmm.
Do you find that because you are a male hygienist that a lot of patients automatically assume that you're the doctor? And I feel like maybe like treatment acceptance is higher because of that. Like they kind of respect you more. Do you get that at all?
I do. So I'm never ignorant to, you know, societal prejudices, right? Like the things that we put out there. Like I'm never ignorant to those things and like, no, I don't think that's a real thing. No, it's real. People really do. I think just because I'm a guy or just because I've heard other guy hygienists who say, I get confused as a dentist all the time, right? Mm-hmm. And it's interesting because when someone says, oh, are you the dentist? And then what does that automatically do? That automatically makes you saying that you're not almost feel like you're lowering it.
Right.
Like I'm lowering below now your expectation of what you thought I was. But so then in that, we have to have this, you know, this kind of vibe where we're like, no, I'm not the dentist, but I am your hygienist. And, you know, and we just got to keep that upbeat kind of tone and authority and respect there. Because I think some people naturally, when you say, when someone comes with this high expectation, like, oh, are you the dentist? And you're like, no, I'm the hygienist.
I'm just the lowly hygienist.
No, sorry to let you down. I'm just the hygienist. I'm present
today.
I think it's really great when you have a dentist who sees you as a hygienist as more of a peer and values your input and conveys that to patients. I think that helps kind of raise up what we do. So
yeah, I actually talked to my office and told them we have to build in edification. So this is something that I learned through personal development. You guys know edification?
Lightness.
Edifying someone is essentially what that the role of the person introducing has, right? So if before I come in, if you say, hey, I'm going to go get Chris, right? That's not a really good way to edify me and to create the respect like you would if the dentist was coming, right? You say, hey, I'm going to go get Dr. Smith, right?
Yeah.
That title of doctor automatically edifies and gives them respect. And so when we're introduced or spoken about before we come in the room, you say, you know, I'm going to get Chris, our hygienist, right? Yeah. That statement alone automatically edifies you. And then you could say some other nice things like, I'm going to go get Chris, the hygienist. He's really great. He's going to talk to you about such and such and such, right? That automatically puts him it puts me or the hygienist in a more advantageous spot to be respected and heard and our education to shine through. And I agree with you, Heather. I love dentists that actually look at the provider-to-provider relationship as an equal or a team.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I think it'll be really difficult for dentists to, a lot of dentists find it difficult to consider us equals because of the difference in our schooling.
Right.
But they do respect and understand that we're just as educated. It just didn't take as long. And we didn't learn restorative as much. Our studies were mainly rooted in prevention. And so one of the things that I thought would be really good in a practice I was working in is if we divided the practice by saying, this is the restorative side and this is the preventative side.
Yeah.
Right.
I say that all the time to my patients. So it's like going to see a specialist. Like, do you need something restored
or are you? Yeah. Mm-hmm. I love that. I love that verbiage.
Yeah. If I have a hygiene patient going over to have some work done next, I always, you know, all right, I'm going to get you numbed up for your restorative appointment. Nothing new today. So you're doing great at preventing, you know. No, I really don't. I'm not like that, but
yeah, you are.
I am. But I'm not. I don't know.
I can actually hear you saying that.
Yeah. Well, you know. Got my smile on, my teeth sparkle, so wink my eye.
I don't know any male hygienists. I've never worked with one or anything like that. But kind of talking about like what Heather just kind of unwittingly touched on there is I would love to be kind of a fly on the wall because I've never had that dynamic with, you know, a male hygienist. What the difference is, you know, because we chit chat, we talk. There's a lot of like, you know, the bubbly cheerleader personality thing going on. And I feel like some of us lay it on pretty thick. I mean, I know I annoy the hell out of myself with these patients, with the way I act, because it's really not how I am in real life. It's like I open that door to the waiting room for my first patient and it's showtime. It's like I'm a different person. So I'm just wondering like if you guys have to turn that on to, I don't know. It's just something I was thinking about. Like, do you guys have to be like bubbly or is it a different expectation for you guys not to be all like chit-chatty about this, that, and the other? So I don't think that Anna's as chit-chatty as probably Heather and I, because she's in New York and New York people are mean. And
chair, we got to get going. Let's go. No.
Yeah. And Heather and I are in Indiana and it's like Midwestern nice.
Yeah, I say ope like 5,000 times. Ope, I'm sorry, you got to take that call. You go right ahead. Ope, no, you got to go to the bathroom.
We don't like small talk.
We're right on time. Sure, go potty.
Everyone's go potty. Got somewhere right to go.
Waiting. Yeah.
Anyway, I would just like to be a fly on the wall to see how different the social dynamic that I would like to see the difference. If there is any, there may not be any, but I'm just sitting here trying to think of like Chris sitting in the room next to me treating patients versus me sitting, you know, in my room treating patients and how different the energy of those appointments would be.
Yeah. I mean, our personalities are already probably very different.
Oh boy.
but I navigate, you know, I navigate it like I would, or, you know, like anybody would a conversation with another person. Pleasantries, right? You find some common ground. You talk about what we're here for.
Yeah.
I often refer to appointments with me, especially when I talk to guys, when I have guy patients, it feels just like being at the barbershop, right?
Yeah.
It's like the same type of, we can talk about sports, girls, you know, current trends and news. We can talk about stocks. We can talk about whatever, really. I think dental hygiene really, really creates a playground of conversation if you are a people person.
Yeah.
And if you're a person like of the world, you can talk about anything with anyone.
Yep.
And so that's just what it is, you know. All of the things, just like this, like if you were a patient, our conversation would be a lot like this. We would just tie in a little bit of dentistry too, like,
yeah,
okay, so let me show you these x-rays. Do you know what you're looking at here? Have you ever seen an x-ray before? Okay, let me give you a quick crash course on how to read x-ray, right? And I just go through really fast. I mean, it's probably very similar to what you guys do.
Yeah.
It's just with my personality.
My patients love to look at x-rays.
Yeah. I think it's just like reading your audience, just matching energy. Because, you know, you'll have a patient who's just quiet and you feed off of that. And you're like, okay, I can tell this person doesn't want a whole lot of interaction. And then you have like, you know, these old ladies who haven't seen, you know, their family in 6 months. And they just want to talk all about like their cats and their grandchildren and their, you know. Yeah.
It's more of they're there to get their teeth cleaned, but more for
social
therapy.
Yeah, for social hour therapy. Yeah. Someone to talk to.
Oh man, been through it all. The therapy sessions, the coaching sessions, we are laughing nonstop.
Yeah. Absolutely. I love those appointments. Those are my favorite.
I know. I love those too. I love when people come in with good energy. But I'm also okay when people come in with bad energy, because I feel like I've become a master at changing that.
Yep.
When people come in and they just got the weight of the world on their shoulders and they're like, they were stressed out because they were running late to their appointment, and then they got all these things going on in their life. And then it's like, hey, well, listen, you're here now. And this appointment could be really good if we just, you know, enjoy this moment.
Yep.
But if you stay in your head, it'll just be a drag for you.
Yeah. Yeah. I try, if people are like that, just be like, even if in my head I'm like, oh my gosh, I am like 30 minutes behind and blah, blah, blah. But I try to portray, it's okay. It's fine. Stuff happens. Let's just take a deep breath. Mm-hmm. For a minute, it's okay. You still get your time.
Yeah, I've had those moments where I had to change people, because like if we're running behind, right, and then you walk into the room with the next patient who's like upset now that you're behind, right?
Yeah.
It's a simple thing for me. The last patient that I had just needed a little bit more time and attention.
Yes,
and I didn't want to make them feel rushed, and I don't want to make you feel rushed either. So I'm here now, and you have all my attention.
Yes.
But that last patient needed me and my attention. So once I relate those two where I'm like, they just needed me more. Right.
Yeah.
Just like you might need me, and I don't want to rush to the next patient because you might need that this time. So, and they're like, okay, I can't really argue with that.
Yeah. I think just letting them know that their time is appreciated and,
yep,
you know, thank them for being so patient and. But yeah.
Yeah. I wanted to ask though, like, I love your positivity about being a hygienist. Like, everything you've said has been super positive, but I wanted to kind of hear about some of the negative, you know, like, we are RDH rant after all, but I don't know, like, what has been, like, what is your biggest rant about being a male hygienist? Is there anything negative that goes along with that?
Yeah, so, I mean, big thing was kind of what we talked about earlier in the conversation, which is the scope of practice and the inconsistency in our, you know, just how we look as a career field across the United States and beyond. So that's a huge, like, I'm like, that just, that's irritating. Me being a Georgia dental hygienist and coming out into the profession and learning about other hygienists who can administer local anesthesia and we can't.
Yeah.
I'm originally from California and I see the hygienists in California are freaking, first of all, killing it when it comes to, you know, what they're making. I mean, the cost of living is different there too. So
right.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
But I've also seen they're able to do fillings and maybe even those simple extractions like you talked about in the other state, mm-hmm. Heather. So that, then of course I have my clinical and just my clinical rants where I can't stand when a patient comes in late and waits until I come to pick them up from the lobby and then they have to use the bathroom. Like, that gets me every time. The feud and war between, it's like a secret coalition of dental assistants that hate dental hygienists. And they just like to find reasons why they don't like you just because you're a hygienist.
Oh yeah.
That whole feud,
right,
in the industry, that's a huge rant for me.
I'm thankful I've never experienced that personally in my offices, but I see a lot of it.
Yeah, I hear about it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I just try to be a team player. So I think I'm actually surprised you have as many rants as you do. I don't think of you as a person that has negative towards a lot of things, but
that's the Chris Love.
Yeah.
you know why that is? You know, let me explain that too. So, because I don't want people to think, you know, it's just like a woo-woo kind of, you know, thing, or I'm just trying to be like this ultra positive guy and I'm not real. Like, nah, I have a lot of, you know, things that irritate me and bother me, but I've learned where to place my energy. And I think I really made that shift when I was in the military, actually, and I was in Afghanistan in one of the shittiest conditions you can kind of, you know, yeah. I mean, people have had, you know, worse, I'm sure. But
yeah,
for me, I remember having times where we just complained about things all the time, right? When we were there. And now we're talking about things that could mean your life. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So yeah. We would complain about things that we just thought was dumb. But our complaints never made anything better, right? Because we decided to join the military. We decided to, you know, raise our right hand and we're here from our own choices. And so in some ways, right? Because
yeah,
the government makes choices to go to war with countries and then next thing you know, you're getting shipped out, right? But ultimately, as an active duty military member, I volunteered. I wasn't drafted, right? So
yeah,
throughout life, I just learned to be grateful for where I am, especially because I've experienced a lot of death in my life. And so just choosing to live happy and figure out just really where to put my energy, where to put it, you know, when it comes to like things that I want to change or that I think should be different, I just choose to see them differently or make the change if I have the power to. And when it comes to how I feel about stuff, I always have that option, right? That's where emotional intelligence comes from. So for me, that's why I do have that positive outlook on life, because I've seen so much negative and I just choose not to really put any more negativity in the world.
Yeah. Oh, that's great.
I like it. I think Chris Love.
Me too.
Not really an alter ego. Just you 100%. Amplified, right? Yeah. So before I think we lost Anna due to a technical difficulty. So we're going to kind of wrap things up here. Before we go, tell us about Dental Culture Con.
Absolutely. Yes, I'd love to. So Dental Culture Con is the birth child of mine and Carice Laguerre, who's also a dental hygienist. She doesn't practice clinically. She's more a mile. She's a mild functional therapist, and she does a lot of work in airway. Okay. And so we actually came up with this concept from just the need in the space of dentistry to have a place that really represented diversity and inclusion. We talk about this a lot. There's a lot of people that support this mission, but we don't have a place where we can collectively celebrate all DEI initiatives. A big part of one of my passions as well and Carice's is culture. And so our conference really centers around diversity, equity, and inclusion as one pillar, workplace culture, and patient culture. There is a ton to be learned as far as who makes up our industry and how that representation is shown and how aware we are of it. We have patients that are LGBTQ. We have patients that are in transition from being men to women, women to men. We have underrepresented races within the industry. And I mean, the list goes on and on. So to have a conference where we can come to and kind of see other reflections of us is really important. Recently, like I was telling you guys before, this weekend was the Hinman, which is here in Atlanta. And the Hinman is 100% run and created by old white men. And you can see it reflected throughout the the conference. And now when you look at the speaker lineup, I think I just heard that there was the first black male speaker that spoke at the Hinman this past Hinman.
This year.
And so prior to that conference starting, I did look at the speaker list.
Yeah.
And it was a long list. Not one black man or person for that matter on that list. And so that's a problem.
That is a problem.
Atlanta is known as a black Mecca for entrepreneurship and entertainment. There's so many, you know, powerful black people here. And for there to be a dental conference here in that Mecca, and there's not, you know, that's really crazy. Yeah. So that's just one example, right? That's just one conference of many that have not embodied really diversity, equity, and inclusion. And so Dental Culture Con stands to make that impact in the industry. And we're happy to be spearheading that change. And so we'll be having that event here in Atlanta, June 15th through the 17th.
Okay, that's cool.
So how do they have to like go and like sign up or register, or do you have like something we can add to our link tree and post, or something you want to give a shout out to right now?
Yeah. So you can go to dentalculturecon.com and use code RANT and you'll get a discount on your ticket to the Dental Culture Con.
All right. Woo-hoo. Well, I will make sure to add that to our link tree probably tonight.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Well, I'm excited. I wish I could attend this year. I don't think you never know, but I hope that that's something that you guys do yearly, because I would love to attend that. Cause I think that we do need more cultural competency within our own profession, not just with patients. So I love that you're doing that.
So, 100%.
Anything else, Heather?
I don't think so. I just want to say thanks so much for giving us a guy's perspective in the field, which, you know, obviously we both agree is very underrepresented.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Thank you guys for having me.
Yeah, our pleasure. Anytime.
Yeah. I'm glad we could do this. This was a this podcast, getting this finished was a journey.
It certainly was.
But we made it.
Yes. All right. Thanks for listening to RDH Rant Takeover of A Tale of Two Hygienists. If you have any ideas for future podcasts, please don't hesitate to DM us with your ideas. We'd love to hear them. please join us on our Facebook group of 13,000 hygienists, or I think we might be more than that now. Also join us on Instagram, and we are slowly but surely getting a TikTok started, if TikTok is still around in the next couple of months.
Cool. It'll be a surprise.
Yeah, whatever. So thanks for joining us.
Peace.
Love. Love, peace, and brush your teeth. I am just off the cuff here. Love, peace, and brush your teeth, right? Yeah.
Why don't we say it all together?
Yes. All right. Peace.
Peace. Love.
Love.
And brush your teeth. Bye, everyone.
Bye. Thank you.